Corporation sees a marketing opportunity in Lakewood, Colorado, one of the western suburbs. At the corner of Colfax and Wadsworth, they find a lot, a series of lots that are for sale. It's 30 acres, approximately 1,000 feet by 1,000 feet, big enough for a Walmart. On the corner of Colfax and Wadsworth is a bank and a small restaurant. They plan on leaving the bank and the restaurant. Next to it, along Colfax, is a Chopette, which holds, among other things, a paint recycling store. Along Wadsworth, on the other side, is an auto detail place that specializes in painting cars. There's a small stream that goes across the back of the property. As part of the sale, the title company looks at the past use of this commercial property and finds that the Chopette was built in 1963, but before that, and for many years before that, the property was a Chevy dealership. And before that, for many years, all through the 1930s and the 1940s, the property was a junkyard. They furthermore find that right at the corner, there was a gas station complete with underground gas tanks that was torn down in 1963. There's no records as to whether the storage tanks have been removed or not. Presently, there's a painting establishment in two places, both along Wadsworth with the car painting place, and the Chopette has a paint recycling place, both of which are suspicious. It's very clear that environmental assessment needs to be done on the property before it is sold. The reason for the environmental assessment is really, there's a lot of reasons, but one of them is to protect Walmart. If there's environmental problems on the property, these need to be recognized before Walmart goes in so that Walmart doesn't get blamed for it. And furthermore, if there's problems and they're bad, they need to be cleaned up now before the building is built. When a real estate transaction is done on a commercial property, there usually is an environmental assessment. The environmental assessment is performed by an environmental consulting company. The environmental consulting company consists of environmental engineers. These are people that are specialized in like soil types and soil percolation and the distribution of hazardous waste through layers of soil, and maybe it has to do with building and has to do with the law. I don't really know very much about it. The environmental consulting company has to hire a lab. By regulation, the lab has to be independent, which is where we come in. The purchase price of the 30 acres is $3.5 million. Of that $3.5 million, $400,000 of it is earmarked for the environmental assessment. So the environmental business, it's a pretty big business, and there are jobs in this business. The environmental consulting company goes to the site, and looking at the property, looking at the geology and the geography, they decide what tests they need to have run in order to determine if there's hazardous waste on it. One of the tests that they will order is the EPA 8270. The 8270 is a GC mass spec analysis of the organic components in the soil or water. As often happens, it is defined by the conditions of the test. The 8270 is an analysis for organic materials that are extractable by methylene chloride. Materials that are extractable by methylene chloride include everything that's organic. I think everything that's organic. So it doesn't include, for example, chromate or lead or cyanide.
But it includes anything that's organic, which is anything that's petroleum-based, any organic solvents, anything that has to do with paint, anything that has to do with the manufacture of plastic or the disposal of plastic or old tires or grease or asphalt or anything like that will be extractable in methylene chloride and will be identified by the 8270 gas chromatography mass spectrometry analysis, the GCMS 8270. The 8270 starts out with a liquid-liquid extraction, and that's where we want to start right now. We want to take a more careful look at the liquid-liquid extraction. The liquid-liquid extraction is done in methylene chloride. Methylene chloride is dichloromethane. It's symmetrical. This bond rotates, so there's no dipole, there's no up, there's no top and bottom, there's no nothing. It's round, figuratively speaking. It's symmetrical. It doesn't have a dipole. There's nothing that looks like a magnet in it. Water is, of course, a triangular substance, and it has a minus side and a plus side. Water is hydrophilic. Methylene chloride is hydrophobic. They say like dissolves like. We need another player. Let's use naphthalene. Naphthalene is two benzene rings put together. It's a fairly common pollutant. It's mothballs in common language. It's has a boiling point of maybe 130 or something like that. So it's solid at room temperature. It has a limited solubility in water. So it's not completely insoluble in water. It's important to understand this. It's not completely insoluble in water, but it has a limited solubility. So the equilibrium takes place where the methylene chloride meets the water. So it doesn't happen in the water, and it doesn't happen in the methylene chloride. It happens where the methylene chloride meets the water. So a molecule of naphthalene comes to an interface between water and methylene chloride. What's it going to do? Is it going to stay in the water, or is it going to go into the methylene chloride? The probability is that it will go into the methylene chloride. It's a probability, not a statement of fact. It will 10 to 1 to go into the methylene chloride. So what's the purpose of the separatory funnel? The separatory funnel, your instinct would be to say that you shake the separatory funnel, and the action of shaking the separatory funnel will force the naphthalene into the methylene chloride. But that's not the case at all. Shaking the separatory funnel only increases the surface area between the water and the methylene chloride and allows the natural equilibrium to come, and it allows the equilibrium to happen sooner. The standard procedure is to put water, a liter of water, into a rather large separatory funnel. So it's about this big. Add 100 milliliters of methylene chloride to it, shake it up, let's say 85% of the naphthalene will go into the methylene chloride. Let it sit. If the water is clean, it will quite quickly separate. Drain the methylene chloride into a beaker, add 100 milliliters more methylene chloride, shake it again, drain the methylene chloride into the same beaker, and then do it a third time. The first time, about 85% of the naphthalene will go into the methylene chloride. The second time, 85% of the remaining naphthalene will go into the methylene chloride. So after two extractions, there's not very much naphthalene left. Do it a third time, and you'll end up with 98% of the naphthalene in the methylene chloride. And your intuition would say that shaking the separatory funnel drives the naphthalene into the methylene chloride, but that's not the case at all. Shaking the separatory funnel only increases the surface area and allows the natural equilibrium to occur faster. The methylene chloride does not go out and grab the naphthalene. The methylene chloride simply accepts it more readily than the water accepts it. And that's all there is to it. The 8270 is a good subject for study. The 8270, the EPA 8270 GC mass spec analysis, is one of the oldest established mass spec analyses there is. It's been around as long as quadrupole GC mass spec has been around, which is probably on the order of 25 years, maybe 30 years, something like that. It's been around a long time. I think of the 8270 as the grandfather of all mass spec analysis. Everything came out of the 8270. This is my perception, but whatever. The 8270 is a good subject of study because the 8270 is a very typical analysis. It involves a liquid-liquid extraction, very common. It involves a blowdown procedure, very common. It involves a calibration using an internal standard, which is very common. There's a concentration step, which is, it's a very ordinary analysis, and I think that it's a good subject. The 8270 is a good time to stop and really look closely at something.